The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Corporation.
Rise!
Get yourselves together!
Rise!
Stand up and live your life!
Rise!
Get yourselves together!
Rise!
Hands up high!
Welcome to the Rise Above Show. I am Joe Peroni.
I'm Heidi Mancini.
Announcements.
Okay, my announcements today. Again, I want to thank Jay Young from City Athletic Club for sponsoring our show, the Rise Above Show. And we're live today at www.dbtv.com. So if you want to check us out, you can get to us there today live. And then, of course, all the shows are archived at www.dbtv. We're also on YouTube. So if you look up Rise Above with Joe and Heidi, you'll find our subscription. And if you subscribe to us, then our shows will be sent to you on YouTube. So we do have a subscription, and we would appreciate it very much if you could go there to YouTube, look up Rise Above with Joe and Heidi. If you type in just Rise Above, there's a bunch of other things that are going to come up, but you have to put Joe and Heidi, and our page will come up. You'll see all of our shows archived there that we've currently done in the up to current, past to current, and they're there, and they're also on josephperoni.com. The shows are posted there, and I also have a site on the Facebook page called Rise Above, where I put the pictures and I announce the shows. They're also on Facebook, so we're all over the place, and I don't know if I should do a social experiment or what, but I hear all the time that I can't find you. I clicked on the link. It didn't take me anywhere. If anybody has any suggestions of how we can make it better for you to access us and to get our shows and get the information you need about us, that would be helpful too, because we're trying everything that we can to get our show out there to you. Also, if you'd like us to help you advertise for your business, Joe and I have openings for sponsorship. We could work together to help advertise for you. Also, you could help advertise our show so that we can get our great material out there every week. And I think that's all I have on my, and I mentioned the social media. So yeah, so I'm done.
All right, show's over.
I'm done. So.
Perfect. Okay, so we're going to continue our thoughts and our programs about trauma. And today I really want to talk about childhood trauma and how most of the time, trauma from our childhood, it doesn't repair itself. So if you leave those feelings inside, they're buried alive. And this is from Freud. He said this. If you leave those feelings buried inside, they're buried alive. And they come out as something much worse later on. And also, you'd be very shocked about how many of the things that we do and the things that we say and our behaviors that are connected to past traumas. And you never connect it to that. So a lot of the trauma is unseen. So you don't even think to fix it. So I thought maybe we can take a look at that today, just in the last couple of weeks, I think. So what I did was I went over some of the shows, and including last week's show, and I picked out some of the trauma responses from me and I actually one of our guests, without throwing anybody under the bus, because it's okay, we've all been through stuff. But 2 weeks ago, we had a guest on here that was ahead of the founder of the Elk Institute, and they treat PTSD. It was very interesting. We talked about her father, and when I asked her how she felt about that and her recovery from that and how she dealt with that loss, she started to go into this very interesting response about how she felt it through her parasympathetic nerve system. And then she went into this really convoluted thing, and not to make fun, but it was so intellectualized that I had to challenge her. And Heidi and I had a little conversation after the show. She thought I was a little harsh, and I agreed. But on the other hand, when people are watching or listening to the show, if they heard that, they also do not have to be therapists to know that that is an extremely unusual way to talk about your father dying. In other words, she has not processed it. She made it so scientific. And so right then, we can look. She has not processed that trauma. And when I questioned her again, she went into the same approach. So she was not ready at
that
moment.
Well, she wasn't, maybe, you know, we talked about this too, and I said the intellectualized part of that conversation was, I think that there was part of it that was a technical thing on that end too, that she was trying to share her technical knowledge, because we all know, when we know what we know, and you do this too, sometimes you'll throw words out there just, you know, to make it, you know, like, I'm a professional, this is my job, this is my verbiage, this is how I talk. She may not have processed that all the way, but I don't think that she felt maybe on that particular time was the time that it wasn't really an emotional time for her to let loose, because she did mention to me later that she felt that she got a little clinical. So she did realize that, you know, what she had stated was a little more on the clinical side of that. She realized that later, and if it was okay. And, you know, so I'm not really sure.
No, I...
You know, I get what you're saying, that I think her response was a little bit... me initially, because I didn't even know what the heck she was talking about, honestly, because I've never heard anybody describe that about somebody dying in those terms.
Right.
But then I thought, well, maybe, and you know, you do this, counselors talk to people a certain way when they talk and they do therapy. There's all the same language that people use. So I'm thinking maybe that was her response.
Yes, it was the best response that she had at the time. Again, I'm not making fun or anybody. What I'm pointing out is that we're all human beings, and that is a response to a trauma that was not fully processed yet. And so she did start to use technical terms, and then when I asked her again, I gave her another chance, she did it again, and then I asked her for a third time. And then that's when I thought, okay, I'm being a little bit mean right here, so I stepped it back. But she knew what we were getting at. So that's just one thing that I pulled out of the tapes that we had. Last week, we did a memorial type thing in the first 10 minutes for a Maverick, the dog who died. If you go back to the tape, what you'll see me is in a very moment where it was very sad for me, I actually laughed, right? Like, that's totally inappropriate. And in no way, shape, or form did I think that reading that about a dog was funny. But what that was is, somewhere deep inside me, I still have that socialized thing that a man should not show feelings publicly, at least what we would call weak feelings. I don't particularly, you hear me say it, I don't think a man crying is particularly weak, but yet my internal part of me lied because I laughed when I came to that part. So there's a part of me that's not totally okay with that. And so that's what I'm saying. A lot of trauma, and it's not even just real in-depth harsh trauma. It doesn't have to be like abuse, but just the little things in life, the way society tells you to be a different person than what you are, those even micro traumas, those things do come up in very interesting ways.
And I think people go through life managing their trauma because, you know, as a trainer and as a hairstylist, I've been behind the chair 30 years. And I just started doing personal training and wellness coaching for women. And, you know, one of the things that I've noticed is that people, a lot of times, they don't know that they've managed symptoms or they've managed abuse. They've done the best that they can and they've gotten through their lives okay, you know, managing whatever they have to manage. There are people also that will continue to manage their trauma because they never have to face it, because they're in whatever relationship they're in, or they choose. I know people that choose to be alone. They say, I don't want a male in my life. I want to be alone. I just want a guy around when I want to have a little fun here and there. And what that says to me is that, no, that's not what you really want. What you're saying to me is that you haven't matured enough through whatever pain that you've had, whether it be with bad relationships, you know, whatever your definition of bad relationship is, because we're all part of that. You know, we all want to point the finger on the other person and say, well, they're the whole blame for the relationship not working out. And it could be a romantic partner. It could be with our children. It could be with a friendship. It can be with a coworker. If you start looking at things, you can see why And I mean, this isn't being mean, but you can see why some people are alone. They choose it because they don't want to do the internal work. Right. They would much rather be alone in their own thoughts, in their own place, and maybe extend themselves just enough on a superficial level, but that's manageable to them. So I don't think everybody wants to be changed or they need to be changed.
Well, that's true. John has a question.
John has a question.
Actually, I want to address what you had said, Joe, about when you were reading the story about Maverick and how you kind of laughed or chuckled a little bit.
I did.
I'd like to share a story, if it's okay.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay, I was in high school. There were three of us. They called us the Three Musketeers. We were best friends since, like, the fifth grade. And one of them died. He had a hole in his heart, went into the hospital, had an operation, came out 5 days later. Phil and I were someplace else, and he came to Phil's house, walked up the stairs, got the top stairs, knocked on the door, collapsed, fell down the stairs, and was dead. So when we went to view his body in the chapel, in the church, Phil and I walked up to the casket, and we both looked at each other and started laughing. We had to leave the chapel. I mean, you know, we started snickering, and that was the only way that we could handle the situation.
So you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, it took us years to figure out, because, and we had talked about it over the years, you know, it's like, God, what a sucky thing to do. He was our best friend. He was, you know, it was, we went every place, everywhere, and you know, we finally figured out there was no other reaction we could have had.
Right.
Because based at, you know, this is back in the mid 60s, and you know, so I understand that completely, and you know, to this day I feel bad about it, but I understand it and I know why that happened. So
yeah, well, I'm glad you found the root cause of that, because I watched the tape back,
yeah,
and I was like, I felt so bad because I'm trying to do this heartfelt talk. And I actually laughed it off. And what actually triggered in my brain, now that I'm going through it all, is because I've had some people that should remain nameless go, oh, it's just a dog. And I don't want to be put, yeah, I know I don't have enough middle fingers, right? But I don't want to be put in that category of people. And by laughing, I thought, oh God, I just did it now. You know, someone's going to think that of me, and that's the last thing I want them to think of it. It was just a response, and I don't remember. It just came out. It was a fear response on my part.
I remember the show, and I know at that point, if you hadn't have chuckled, you would have broke down and cried.
Oh, absolutely.
You were at that point. I mean, I was sitting here waiting for that to happen.
Yeah,
and when I saw you chuckle, I thought, okay, he's got past that point. He's got himself past that.
So. Yeah, it's a major defense mechanism of mine. Let's say that.
Sorry.
And
don't be sorry. Because
thank you. Everybody can hear you, right? your mic turned up.
But people, when you have responses, you don't know sometimes why you're having the responses you have. I've said that to myself over and over in my life. I go, why does that get me every single time? Why does, when that situation comes up, does that, and I'm going to use the word tweak because that's the only word I can come up with, but it's like, why does that get me every single time? And then, you know, with the therapy and with Joe and that, you start to learn that there's reasons, and they're really deep reasons, but you're able to manage it. Like you said, you can go through your life and you can manage things most of your life. And some people, their entire lives, they'll live their entire lives out and never have to have a consequence or have a repercussion from them, you know, managing whatever problems they've grown up with or abuses that they've had. They've learned to manage it well. And then there's other times that you go through life and you go, well, you know, I've heard women say, I always pick the wrong guy. Or I've heard men say, you know, women are this way or that way. And it's like, well, that's your perception of what you're seeing. But you, and I tell everybody all the time when we talk about it, I said, you're part of it. You know, you're part of why a man treats you the way he treats you. You're the man is part of the way a woman treats him. And, you know, I just had a conversation with somebody on Messenger this morning about that, and he said to me, but I don't want to come across as being a narcissist. And I said, well, one thing about narcissists is they don't really care. So
yeah, they don't have empathy.
They don't have empathy. So the fact that
if you're asking, you're not.
But I said the fact that you're saying that, I'm saying you're not. And I said, it's good to make boundaries, you know, put boundaries and know what you want.
So part of what I wanted to, not super technical part, because I'm trying to like put all this stuff in together. I want it to be very conversational so people can totally get into it and feel what they feel for themselves. But I want to get slightly not technical, but just in a way to help people. In this part, the way I've been doing it for a number of years now is I try to have as much self-awareness as I can of what I'm saying and what my behaviors are. So I sit back and I go, okay, what did I just do? Right? So self-awareness. And then if it's something that I don't like, something that I felt in my body, right? Like my heart rate jumped or my behavior was off or I laugh for a ridiculous reason, then I do the self-inquiry. I ask myself questions. So the first part is what do I feel? And the second part is why? Why do I think I feel that way? Why did I act the way I did? And so you start looking into that. And then I go, okay, I see that. And then let's improve on it. Like there was a really simple one last week that came up. Wow, I had a lot of them last week. I was talking about my mother, and what happened was, this is a Freudian slip. I meant to say my mother, but what I said was my sister, and I stopped, and then I went, oh, my mother. What that really, like, why would the mother and sister have nothing to do with it? They're not even close the way they sound. But this is the trauma part that comes up a lot in therapy, and I'll tell it to you now. It's called parentification. So it means that the child takes the step up into a parental role. So in this case, I mentioned my mother as my sister because there are parts of me, unconsciously, subconsciously, that really feels that we were on the same level. Mm-hmm. Because I said, when you're very young, 5 or 6, my father's gone. He is, in say my mother's words, a disappointment. I have to come in and give her something to be proud of. So I'm a young man in the household making her proud. Mm-hmm. And already living a life that she doesn't have to take any extra time to be angry or to be hurt or to be betrayed. Everything I came home with was, I'm home from school. There you go. Straight A's. There you go. Put this on the fridge. It's pretty awesome. Best one in the class. Guess who's the captain of the football team? That would be me. Guess who's captain? So it was that. So it was more like I was managing her life and her feelings. So I had to be perfect. So in that sense, it's parentification. Like then she would talk to me because there was nobody else around and I would see things. Like I was there when she would have a conversation with my father and then I was, or on the phone or something like that. And then I would see her and she would walk in the bedroom. She would cry. She would pull out the scale from underneath the bed. She would weigh herself and say something, you know, bad about herself. And I was already learning that bodies meant a lot to people. And it was like, wow, you know. And then my father had this fat phobia. You know, he would, you know, he'd say the same thing to me, like, you sure you want seconds? I'm like, well, I'm hungry. I guess not. So it warps your reality because when you're very young, you don't have a fully grown ego, let's say. So your ego gets bent by the person that's around you because you're trying to figure out a way to survive this. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't want to get hit. I don't want to be yelled at. I don't want to be made fun of or humiliated. And I saw that in my mother. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow, I didn't say to myself, I'm going to be a trainer. But what happened was I developed a lot of empathy for women. And I become very protective. You know, I almost had a fight with a guy at a bank like 3 years ago. It's kind of funny. We're in line at the bank and this guy's yelling at one of the tellers, like, come on, you know, hurry up already. You don't have to say hello to everybody. I just want to get out of here. And I slowly walked over to him and I went, keep talking to a woman like that. This is going to be a very difficult day for you. Mm-hmm. And I stepped back and he just went, real calm. And I'm not a violent guy. It's just that I don't like women being yelled at. I don't like women being made fun of. I don't like any of that. Not that anybody really does, but there's an extra thing that when I heard that guy say it, my heart rate, everything, I get that, ooh, that shot of adrenaline. Where did I get that from? Oh, it could be from when I was trying to jump on my father's back making them stop, you know, trying to hit my mom, that kind of stuff. So it always comes back to bite you. But if you have awareness and then you ask yourself questions, you can look at it and go, okay, this is not really happening right now. My reaction might be a little too much for the actual situation. Mm-hmm. And then you can cut it back. And so you learn. So one of the things in therapy, people come in, I don't talk it too much, but they'll say, well, can I fix this? Can I make it all better? Yeah, I'm not saying no. Sometimes you can. Sometimes you can. But to me, the goal is not to forget about your past, because that's part of you. Once it's downloaded into the amygdala and the brain and the hippocampus, you can't get rid of it. But what I've done in a really good way, and it's not bragging, it's just saying that I've been able to handle it, and I'm really glad that I have, because my days are really good right now. Is that I've been able to turn down the volume really, really low to the point where I almost need a hearing aid to hear it. Like every once in a while, something will happen and I'll hear it, that voice going, Joe, you're not good enough. But it's really low, really low. It used to be so loud I couldn't hear anything else, you know, to where someone, you know, a teacher would call me to go up in front of the class and I would be like, oh. Like I would feel like I couldn't even move my legs, you know, it was like so bad. But now it's there, but so low, you know, it's just so much better. And that's how you do it. Awareness, then inquire about yourself. Why do I feel like this? And where have I felt like this before? Mm-hmm. Where did I learn it? And just keep inquiring about yourself. Socrates said the unexamined life is not worth living. I don't know if I agree totally with not worth living, but it's really hard to live if you haven't examined yourself, because then you're doing and saying things and feeling things that you don't know why. And if you're not asking why, you can't fix it. Just turn down the volume. Mm-hmm. I'll let you speak for a while, because I could speak about this all day.
Well, it's exactly what you said. It's called managing. You manage and then you become aware. You know, one of the things that, and I'm going to give an example of myself.
Yeah.
This has nothing to do with what I'm not going to bring up my childhood, but I will say that I've always had self-esteem issues. I've never thought I was pretty. I never thought I was, you know, whatever. It doesn't matter. But a lot of that did come from, you know, the way I was raised in the family I was raised in. And one of the things I've been working on the last couple of years, which hopefully I don't have to do this again after this year, is I've been trying to get on stage and people go, what is your big deal? Like, are you, you know, conceited? Are you... You know, what is your problem? Why would you want to do that? Mm-hmm. My goal has been to be able to get up in front of people and be comfortable and not worry so much about, I don't look like this person or she looks kind of uncomfortable. I want to be able to show who I am and not be judged and get out of my own head and my own beliefs. And one of the things I've been doing is I've been working with people over the years, trainers, I've been working with therapist, you know, I go to counseling here and there to help with it. But I also, you know, I hire people to help facilitate, you know, getting through stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, like I have a choreography coach now that I work with. I've had one last year. They have the skill to help me, you know, present. But it helps me and my brain see myself and feel the way I'm supposed to feel in that moment.
Right. And you're working on it. That's a good thing.
But it helps me with, you know, every part of what I do, not everything, but I mean, it helps me, the discipline part. And then, you know, when you're trying to manage other things, like some of the stuff, emotional stuff, I try to manage. What frustrates, it can frustrate me a little bit, is I can manage some parts are really manageable. Like the physical part for me is very manageable. I'll train the shit out of my body. I'll diet, not maybe not as hard as he does, but I'll definitely, if I have a goal, I'll stick with it for that 12 weeks, 16 weeks, whatever it is. But I will beat my body to the point of wherever I have to take it. And there's a part of me that when it comes to the emotional part of dealing with stuff, I have a really hard time with that still, where I still have to, I can't go, I gotta, you know what, I don't want to feel that right now. I'm going to move on. Let's go throw some more weights around. Let me go do another client's hair. Oh, I know. I'm going to take the dogs for another walk. Oh, I know. I'm going to clean the kitchen floor and I'm clean the garage. Joe, the garage looks great, doesn't it? Everything's put away, you know, that kind of stuff. And that's how a lot of people manage things. They think that when they have OCD, I just talked to a client the other day. she said her, and I was told too, you need to make time for yourself, Heidi time, fun time. And my client and I were talking about it, and she goes, the joke was, is I set a goal last year that I was going to read a book, and I was going to read a book for fun. Not what I do for the show, not what I do with personal training, not looking things up for hair. That's informational stuff to me. That's not fun stuff. That's to make me be able to do my jobs better. And I did, and never did it. I never read a book last year. So she said, you never read that book. And this is a client that reads a book. She read 300, and there's 300 how many days in a year? 60? She read a book every day. She averaged, or actually it went over that. She went to like 380-something books that she read. She said, that needs to be a goal for you. And I said, but it's hard for me because when I go home, I don't go home and say, I'm going to pick up this book and read. I go home and say, I have to put the laundry away. I have to start dinner. You know, and I'm like this at work too. Like, I just don't go to work. And if I have time to sit in my chair and relax, I'm in my files looking up my clients' names. I'm straightening out my color drawers. I'm, you know, doing other little tedious little jobs that, you know, and people say, oh, that's so awesome. You're such a perfectionist and you're OCD and you're all this. That's not good. I mean, that's not a great quality. I mean, it's a managed quality. It's how you manage.
Do you know what I think when you're doing all that?
You know, it's busy work.
Here's an example. You didn't even know I did this because I don't think you looked at it. But I was trying to have some fun and I was drawing on my board to make people understand how huge childhood trauma is, how big it gets. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I did, and I didn't have enough room on this board, but let's look at it real quick, right? If you have, let me see, is it in the camera? There you go.
God, smack me in the head. Boom, knock her out.
Okay, so without you and I figuring this out before we got on the air, the invalidation of a child, right? You could talk that in a lot of different ways. You talked about your mom last week, and there's other things. But what you have is what we call a narcissistic wound, right? In other words, I need to overcome that. It doesn't mean that you're a narcissist. It just means you're going to have to watch out for yourself for a while. You got to take care of yourself. So the invalidation of you goes to a narcissistic wound. You can go in a lot of different directions. One of them that you're just going right down my list. You go to a perfectionist, and in order to be a perfectionist, you have to be OCD, right? And then it kind of goes on with there, and what happens is sometimes you put up this shield, right? And what you'll do is you'll either A, project, or you can't handle criticism. How am I doing, right? Because what'll happen is if I criticize you, you will absolutely deny it. And you'll say, oh, no, that's not true. Well, that's part of the trauma response. Mm-hmm. And John correctly said last week, he's like, it seems like everybody has all these things. Mm-hmm. That's my answer, yes.
Yeah.
Just in varying degrees. Like, just in the last couple of sentences you said, you just went right through my whole board.
And people will say this. People will say all the time, well, it's not like I do drugs and I drink and I do stuff. I could. And,
true,
okay, you've done this comparison. He'll say, I don't do drugs. I come home at night. I'm a, you know, blah, blah, blah. And people will say things like that. They'll say, well, that's another way of managing. People that do drugs, people that drink, people that have sexual addictions. I'm looking at John. I'm not saying whatever. But I'm just saying, these are all adaptations, as they say in counseling. That's
absolutely.
That's a word they use. So OCD, perfectionism, what you just said before.
There's a ton of them.
Those are so many adaptations that people have, and people will make that analogy all the time. They'll go, well, I don't do drugs. And I said that to a therapist. And I said, well, I could have went the other way, and I did drugs, and I drank, and I was a prostitute, and I could have done a lot of things that people do. She goes, well, good for you that you did it. That's great that you didn't. However, you know, you got all this on this side too. So I'll in my brain say, well, I could have went the other way. I could have been, you know, whatever, but so they're all
right.
All
no, and I agree, and that's why I find it.
But we point the finger at the drink, the drunk, the prostitute, the drug addict. We're in society, we do that all the time. We go, well, they're the ones that can't handle their problems. But people, whatever we want to classify people that are in this room right now, out in the salon, in the gym, everybody has adaptations. Everybody
true.
Manages. They get through the day.
But and that's why once you understand
however
that,
they can.
That's why I find the whole subject fascinating because I read every second I get that I'm not actually working. I'm reading because there's so much covert, you know, it's like under the cover thing that you're not seeing. Mm-hmm. Like going back to you just for a second, because I love the way you did it. You fell right into that trap.
Right into this trap.
Like what you'll do is, right, I'll say to you, I read books all the time. I placed a book on your nightstand. Did you see it? You go, oh,
yeah.
I'm not. No, but your answer is this. I don't read because I work for a living. I'm like, I have three jobs. So that's your projection. Like you're trying to take it and throw it on me that you're better, right? Somehow you're going to try to make me feel bad that you didn't read a book. That's the point. The problem is, besides, you know, it's just an adaptation. The other part of you, and you've said this many times, you were called stupid so many times in your life that doing this and looking at a page, it triggers you because you're like, I don't know if I can get all this information. This is what smart people do. I'm not saying you're not smart. Mm-hmm. You tell yourself that. You have fear of opening up a book. You know, and that's just it. And I'm not making fun of you. Listen to me. I feel sad. It's hard to watch. That's why I said, do you know what I see? When you have low-level anxiety all the time, and you will when you have a disorganized upbringing, mm-hmm. right? You don't even know half the stuff that happened to you, right? You have no memory before 5 years old. And I'm telling you, if you remember some of the things you remember with your mother yelling at you, screaming at you, this fight, that fight, mm-hmm. if you remember that when you were six, trust me, it didn't start on your sixth birthday. This thing started from probably when you were, you know, getting removed from the hospital the day you were born. So those things are so deeply ingrained into your brain that you have low-level anxiety, and that's mm-hmm. okay. So do I. But you can manage it. But one way that some people manage it is by not being a total human being. They become a human doing, mm-hmm. right? So I can sit back and relax for 3-4 hours and watch a football game now, just because I like it so much. Mm-hmm. But you can't relax. You need to do this, 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 that, and the other thing under the disguise of, I'm a very productive worker. No, you're not. You're moving stuff from left to right to left to right to forward to back. You're not doing anything, you know, most of the time, right? Like, I have to wash clothes. No, you don't. It's a washing machine. That's what I bought it for. You throw it in there,
be careful.
It does itself.
You're going to go over to uncharted territory here with the females. Don't go there.
No. But, well, then they need to hear it. Because some of these things really don't take a lot of time, right? Like if you're going to meet Johnny Depp at the door at noon on Sunday, this is what you would do.
Oh,
can I
Amber.
Finish?
Amber
can I
loves him.
What you would do is you would look at the dryer and you would do what I say. You would do this. You would go, press the button. Then you'd go meet Johnny Depp. But being that it's in the house, what you do is you go, oh, I have to look at the clothes bounce. And then I have to think about more clothes I might want to put in the dryer later. You get what I'm saying? It's a human, and I'm helping you here, okay, if you allow it. Because you are. You're a human doing. You're always trying to stay busy because you don't want to be in your head, which is actually a good response, right? Because what you could do is shoot up heroin. That's what people do when they want to leave their brain. And you're just cleaning the house. Now, but see, I look and I go, I'm a beneficiary. It's a clean house. Stay traumatized. That's cool. House is clean.
Keep your mouth shut.
Yeah, I don't say anything. But I do know that underneath the clean house, not underneath the clean, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, underneath
within
the clean house
is a person who has a lot of difficulty staying in your own thoughts, just being there. And that has to be hurtful. That, I mean, just to sit on a beach, just to sit back and relax and enjoy, you know, the time, wouldn't that be nice? Mm-hmm. But you can't. I mean, your body will be there, but your brain is all over the place because it doesn't want to stay on, you know, it, sometimes you just need to blank it out. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean drugs. I just mean there's a difference. When you handle the anxiety, you'll be able to sit. And when somebody says read a book, you won't go, oh, well, it's because of this. No, you won't. You'll say, I have not made the proper time to read a book at this moment. That's it. That would be the line. You know, that would be the untraumatized line.
Untraumatized.
You know,
I have not made the time yet, Joe, to read this book, but I will.
Speaking of, I want to throw this trauma story out there because it's such a big one that I read this week, and it was really, it's like, it's an amazing thing. They have this it's called a longitudinal study. It's been going on since like 1975. And what they were doing is they were doing this program to help people lose weight. I'm like, oh, great, psychology and, you know, bodybuilding stuff. I'm in, so I'm reading it. What they decided to do was call back all the people that had lost over 100 pounds and ask them why they quit. Now, some of them quit because they lost 100 pounds and they thought, okay, I'm good. You know, that's a lot. But then they were like, well, why don't you want to keep on the maintenance program, though? You know, it would be weird to quit after that. And the other ones who needed to lose more, they would quit at about the 100-pound mark. And you're like, this makes no sense. Until they started doing the questioning. And what they realized is that of the group of people who quit, who lost 100 pounds, 50% were sexually abused. Huh. Think about that. So if you're a trainer and you look at someone and you're trying to make them lose weight and they're like, well, why aren't you trying hard to really get on your diet? Why do you stop when you start doing so well? For a lot of people, they're becoming more and more attractive, and they don't want to be more attractive because then they feel like they're more and more of a target. So the point that I'm making here is another way that childhood trauma is unseen to most people. It's hidden underneath a lot of stuff. So you can take an anorexic and say, okay, this person is trying to get smaller and smaller so they can almost disappear, right? And that way. Or you could say the other way, a person who gains weight is doing that so they feel like they're less attractive.
It's a covering.
And then they're
it's like it's
up.
A cocoon. It's a covering. It's protection. That's how people that, when I look at somebody that's, and I'm talking obese, not overweight. We have a lot of overweight people around, but I'm talking, when I see somebody walking around that's obese, I look at that person, I go, that person has a lot of pain.
Oh,
and they
yeah.
have a lot of stuff they're trying to cover up. I don't look at them as a fat person that needs to go on a diet. I look at them in a different way as far, and I feel bad, you know, because I know that there's a lot going on underneath all that. So, you know.
No, I agree with you. And that's, you know, part of it, I saw with my mom when I was younger. Like, I don't make fun of any of that. That, to me, I look at someone and I go, wow, there's a lot of pain there. You know, it's like, again, their drug of choice would be food. My drug of choice has been to work out. I mean, I just chose something different. But it's not, in terms of the process, I had a developmental need. It was blocked. I didn't get it. And then, so I went around and I found something that works because society encourages us to look a certain way. Society encourages us to have a college degree. So I did all that. And so I come out the other side. So interesting, though. I was so embarrassed this week. I got to tell you, should I mention this one? You know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we've been doing this show for 4 years, and I take a lot of pride in it. I spend a lot of time reading and writing and trying to get all these different sources from all over the place, and I try to make it to where people want to hear it, and then I also want to make it technical. And so it's kind of like my baby, right? So it's really important to me. And now I have people helping us out to get a little more popular, social media. And I kept going crazy, and Heidi will tell you, I do this because I always want to win. I'm a perfectionist. I'm like, what will it take to get more viewers? What will it take to get more views on whatever, likes on Facebook or YouTube viewers? And I'll look at other people's stuff, and I'll go, oh, this guy popped a pimple, and he has 1.1 million views. I'm like, wow, okay, that really, what am I going to do? You know, so I'm trying to figure out the way. Okay, so this week, of all weeks, this totally embarrassing thing happened to me. I'm at the gym, and Jay Cutler was there. Jay Cutler, if you don't know, he won the Mr. Olympia 4 times. Mm-hmm. The Mr. Olympia is the Super Bowl of bodybuilding. So he's arguably the best bodybuilder on the face of the planet, maybe of all time. Everybody knows who he is. He's got thousands and thousands of followers. He walked next to me and said, hi, Joe, how are you? I said, how's it going there? And he, you know, we just had a little conversation, and I said, so what do you do? And he said, the only thing I really know how to do, man, working out. He turned around, and the guy was filming him. Cool. He talked to me. I talked to him. Great day. 2 days later, when people talk about a picture going viral, hey, I finally did it. But here it is. Now, this would have triggered me when I was young. That's why I'm saying it, because I actually thought it was funny and ironic. But when I was young, public humiliation and my social anxiety would have destroyed me if this happened. What somebody did was, in the video, they took a still of the video. And I guess fanny packs are not in. I wear one, okay? So what they did was, they circled my fanny pack in the picture, and then underneath it, right next to me, they put Fanny Pack Nation.
And a smiley face.
Then they put the emoji of somebody laughing so hard that they were crying. Okay, of all the things I've done in my life to somehow crack the code to get popular, to get more money, this is it. I finally cracked the code, and I was a public... publicly humiliated with the thing, and you could see my face clearly. And to make it even funnier, I was wearing my shirt that had my name on it.
Yeah,
I mean, you can't make it up any better than that. I mean, like, that would have just destroyed me when I was young. I would have been afraid to walk in the gym because everybody's. You know how I found out? People sent it to me. It wasn't even that I found it. Say it again.
Make that your profile picture.
I could do that.
On Facebook.
Can you put it behind, back in? Yeah, I'll send it. You can put it. I mean, of all the things I want to get popular for, that's the only thing that they'll remember me for. I feel like Pee Wee Herman, right? Like, the guy has done really good stand-up comedy. He's done many TV shows. He's done movies. And the only thing he's known for is playing with himself in a movie theater. Like, come on. I'm, what am I, Pee Wee Herman now? Like, that doesn't, oh, God.
I don't think it's the same thing.
Well, no, it's not the same act.
I don't either.
But it's like, is that what they... what they, you know, that's what people remember me for now. I'm like, great, that's the most popular thing I've ever done. Like, that's like so embarrassing.
That's the integrity of our country.
That's the integrity.
Terrible.
That's the
terrible
thing. The dumber you are, and it's with anything. You know, I was just talking to Ava about this yesterday, and she said, yeah, Joe feels bad because, you know, the show, and he wants more people to, you know, whatever. She goes, but he doesn't get it, that the six good people that really listen to you guys, they're intellectual. Listen, wait.
Come
she
on.
Go, no, but listen, that's what she said. I'm minimizing that, but I'm just saying. She said, the six people, she goes, an example, mom, that listen to your show. She goes, they want to learn. They want to know. They want knowledge. They're into your show. She goes, those stupid shows that Joe gets all worried about, that the guys, you know, like you said, the pimple popper or whatever, those... the people that look at that and they support that, she goes, they're like the lowest common denominator. They're not quality. It's a big quantity.
So they vote for Donald Trump.
She goes, does he
want? That's what I want to know.
Does he want quality listeners? She said that are educated, that want to learn, that want to do things and make the world better. Or does he want a bunch of dumb people that really don't care about anything and it's just a bunch of likes over something something stupid that you do? And unfortunately. You know, a lot of things on social media and TV and the news. I mean, nothing ever, very rarely makes the news that's good. All the crap you see on the news anymore, it's always got to be something bad. And unfortunately, that's what people like to see.
That's
They'll
true.
They'll turn the TV up to hear, oh my God, some guy just shot his wife and his two dogs. Oh my God, I got to turn that up.
Jerry Springer type
or Jerry stuff. Springer shows. Look at that garbage. You know, they get on there, they fight, they beat each other up. People love it.
Do you want to go on a break?
Sure.
Because one of the commercials that we have here, I just love. It's only a minute long, and it's so amazing. And it's about kind of what we're talking about. It's having a great idea or just being a great idea.
New ideas.
Say it again?
New ideas.
New ideas. Yeah. And you'll see this, and I hate to admit it, but I'll say it again.
What?
I watched this video.
And you
and
cry.
It made me
cry.
Want to cry. Because it reminded me of me. But I love this. And we also have a little clip of Tom Brady before the Super Bowl, which I just love this video. It's only like 30 seconds long, but it shows you how meaningful and how much we care about our parents. And sometimes, even when some things go wrong here and there, the bottom line is that we still love our parents. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so we'll be right back after these commercials.
Not so many years ago, tomato soup and cream of tomato were unusual dishes, enjoyed very much, but not very often. Today, of all the soups in the world, tomato soup is the one most often served. Not because women have taken to making tomato soup frequently. No, on the contrary, few housewives ever attempt it anymore. There's just one reason for tomato soup's popularity, and it is this. The magic, matchless flavor of Campbell's tomato soup. There's a lively verve, a dashing zest about this flavor that people take to at once and come back to and enjoy again and again. The first racy taste of it has a way of arousing a desire to eat, and yet there's a pleasant feeling of satisfaction when the last spoonful is gone. So this soup is a happy choice for the main dish at lunchtime or at supper, and it also is a fine way to start the day's main meal. Serve it sometimes, too, as cream of tomato, made with milk instead of water. You can always be sure that it will be received with pleasure, because this, of all soups, is the one people like to have most often, Campbell's Tomato Soup.
Welcome back to the Rise Above Show. I'm Joe Peroni.
I'm Heidi Mancini.
And we just have a few minutes left, and just to make sure that we're clear about what we're talking about, because we are talking about child trauma, I want to give you somewhat of a definition. It's hard to clamp down on one, because in the DSM, there is no such thing as CPTSD at this time. One of the reasons why is because once you start diagnosing people with CPTSD, a lot of the other diagnoses will kind of just fade off and go away, because mm-hmm. things like emotional dysregulation, that a lot of these things are encompassed in CPTSD. CPTSD, also known as relationship trauma or interpersonal trauma, mm-hmm. so it could be, you know, obviously in the home. It's also known as developmental trauma disorder. It's a condition that results from chronic, long-term exposure to physical or emotional trauma where the victim has little to no control and there is no escape, highlighted by the failed attempt to manage the caregiver's emotions and behaviors. So think about that. Like, we think about Stockholm Syndrome, right? We think about war, like you're a prisoner of war, like they handle your basic needs. Mm-hmm. But here's an interesting thing. We don't have a lot of time, and we can go over this more on another show, but we talk about codependency, right? Codependency really is that. Like, you are this young, defenseless, naked, needy, dependent child, and you look for your caregivers to tell you what love is. The way you're being treated is what you think love is. Mm-hmm. Now, right from the beginning, there's attachment issues. If you don't have a caregiver that attends to your needs right away, you start thinking something's wrong with me. If something's wrong with me, I have to do something to make you like me. I have to figure it out. That's usually what happens. Mm-hmm. So then you end up going through life trying to manage emotions. Now, the person that's with you, they kind of give you this feeling that you're an annoyance to them. Now, they may not say that, but maybe they work too much. You know, maybe in their mind, they need to work two jobs. And that's probably true a lot of times. But as a child, you don't understand that. You just mm-hmm. know that, why are you not there? How come you don't want to, you know, be around me? So these types of relationships will continue throughout your life if you do not take a look at it and say, why am I doing this? Because people who have, say, very little trauma in their young life will not put up with that. You know, I'm going to try to say this in the easiest way possible. Stop me if you think I go a little overboard. Many times in my life, this relationship will appear over and over and over again because I have become a really good people pleaser, because I had to be when I was young. So I will have a conversation with somebody and think that they're my friend, or we're really actually having a relationship in some way. And what happens is I can be compassionate, I can be caring, I can be empathetic to somebody's opinions, point of view, lifestyle. But then when I notice when they're talking to me, I'm not getting anything back. So what happens is that I'm back in that codependent relationship again, that I'm holding up the wall, right? So if you're a codependent, it exists because you are saying yes to that. And you sit there and you take the abuse. You don't have to be abused. It's like we tried to do it on the show, right? We tried to talk about how you don't have to just deal with black and white thinking. You can do with shades of gray. You can have actual conversations back and forth and deal with people's opinions.
But sometimes, and not to interrupt you on that, you cannot have the conversation because that person is in their own whatever their perception or whatever their managed trauma that mm-hmm. they've managed to manage over their lifetime. So some people, that's why we don't connect with everybody. That's why we can't connect with everybody. We can't have a conversation with everybody because not everybody's open for that.
Right.
And some things are, and I think a lot of friendship relationships, not all of them, but I think most of them are a superficial mm-hmm. relationship. And that's why you get along so well. I think when you have a friend and it's superficial, the fact that you kind of go, oh, it's not that important. I'm not going to like say anything to hurt my friend's feelings. Clients, we do it to clients all the time. A lot of times I want to tell my clients things, you know, or whatever. I'm not going to do that because if there's a consequence to that. So when we're in personal relationships, sometimes you don't hold back.
True. In a personal relationship, good. You should be able to be who you need to be. Here's a little sign.
I think that's how you find out who your friends are, too.
Exactly.
I think you find out.
But here's a little sign for people. If you're mm-hmm. talking to somebody and you feel a little dirty afterwards, like you kind of got somehow the short end of the stick, you know, that somehow someone's trying to get something over on you, mm-hmm. or you feel you have to talk with, like, you're walking on eggshells because if you say the wrong thing, they're going to blow up or leave you or something. You're not having a conversation. At that point, what you're doing is you're in the presence of a narcissist, okay? And that is what's going on. And the only way that that can hold up is if you continue to be in that relationship. You're not going to change somebody. That happens to us on the show. I can get more detail. We don't have a lot of time. But if you go back over the shows, you can use it as a guideline of what it's like to talk to a person who never actually hears you. Mm-hmm. They have their way of thinking and they never go off that. And if you say one thing that they don't like, they're not around. So that's not a real relationship. So you have to understand that in life. If you feel like that, you have to take a step back. You're allowed to draw boundaries. You're mm-hmm. allowed to say, I do not submit. I will not talk to a person who refuses to even look at my point of view. I refuse to have your opinions thrown down my throat. And so you don't have to deal with a narcissist in that way. So we'll get back to this more next week. We'll do plenty of shows on this. I think it's a huge topic. Thanks for watching. This is the Rise Above Show. I am Joe Peroni.
I'm Heidi Mancini.
Dying to ask you a question. He's a Panini Kid reporter. It's a good question too.
What's up, Joseph?
Hi.
How you doing?
But many people say you're their hero, but who's your hero?
Who's my hero?
All right.
It's a great question.
Good question.
Well, I think my dad is my hero because he's someone that I look up to every day. And my dad.